All right, Saagar, what's on your radar?
Well, Ryan, this weekend we found out dozens of women had filed sexual harassment complaints, allegedly, against Michael Bloomberg throughout the course of his career, many of which he quashed from coming to light with non-disclosure agreements. We're now learning, however, that Bloomberg and his company have not only used NDAs to cover up alleged untoward behavior, but have also tried to use them in order to cover up their corrupt covering for the Chinese regime. Lita Hong Fincher, she's a courageous woman married to a former Bloomberg news journalist based in China, published a harrowing account yesterday detailing how the company tried to financially ruin her family after she dared tell the truth about how Bloomberg News actively covered financial misdeeds of high-level Chinese Communist Party officials in order to protect their business interests in China. Fincher is married to Michael Forsyth. He's a well-known journalist who covers China, currently works for the New York Times, who did his job and published a series of exposés about future Chinese President Xi Jinping's family and his ill-gotten wealth while working for Bloomberg in 2012. Fincher received death threats, and worst of all for Bloomberg, Chinese companies began slowing their orders of signature terminals, hurting Bloomberg's bottom line. After Fincher publicly revealed these death threats, Bloomberg News allegedly called up Fincher's husband and demanded that she delete the tweets to avoid embarrassing the Chinese government. Worse, her husband later developed a story that detailed even more financial wrongdoings of the Chinese government. The story, however, never saw the light of day at Bloomberg News, and internal company emails published by the New York Times in 2013 revealed that they directly made the decision not to run the story to protect their business interests in China after the repercussions that they suffered in 2012. After this incident, Bloomberg News hounded Fincher to sign a non-disclosure agreement because she had knowledge of the company's kowtowing to the Chinese regime. It wasn't until she convinced Edward Snowden's lawyers to represent her that she was able to get the company to drop the case. It's a small window into how Michael Bloomberg and the financial empire he has built have actually covered up for the crimes of the Chinese elite in order to preserve their business interests there. Bloomberg claimed at the time his company were not wusses that sucked up to the regime. But the truth is, since that time period, he's only gotten even more beholden to the Chinese. Here he is just a few short months ago flacking for the Chinese President Xi Jinping.
Xi Jinping is not a dictator. He has to satisfy his constituents or he's not going to survive.
He's not a dictator?
No, he has a constituency to answer to.
He doesn't have a vote. He doesn't have a democracy. He doesn't.
That
he's
doesn't
not
mean
held
he can survive
voters.
if his advisors gave him.
Is the check on him just a revolution?
You're not going to have a revolution. Government survives without the will of the majority of its people.
And here's the thing. I thought that might be a one-off. No. Thanks to our friend Zed Jelani, turns out Bloomberg's been saying this for quite some time. Here it is.
Was the public saying to their government, we want to do it. You know, the Chinese government is no less impacted by what their constituents, i.e. citizens, voters, want than any place else. We think that other governments just don't pay attention and only our government does. That's not true. The Chinese government, I've always thought, is very cognizant of what their people want. Sometimes it's something that we don't understand why they want, but they don't understand why we want some things.
As I noted at the time, the comments came right when Bloomberg allowed Chinese corporate bonds into its index funds. And around the same time, Bloomberg announced they would co-host a new economy forum in Beijing with a Chinese government-backed think tank to encourage more U.S. investment in places like China. Michael Bloomberg makes Hunter Biden's dabblings in Ukraine and China literally look like child's play. You won't hear much about this on cable news, despite the fact that these are the people who apparently cared a lot about the Trump Tower Moscow deal. That's because this is the type of Washington, New York corruption that is acceptable to our financial and media elites. They enable and empower the Chinese government to destroy American jobs, steal American technology, and more because it's financially beneficial to their bottom line. Bloomberg is the logical extension of years of global financial policy that empowers Wall Street over workers. His financial entanglements with the Chinese regime alone disqualify him from the presidency. So I asked the same question that I did in October. Is Michael Bloomberg a Chinese asset? He hasn't denied it, so we'll never really know. And it's fascinating, isn't it, Ryan, how how much Bloomberg kowtows to the Chinese regime and how he has basically used his company as this major apparatus. I mean, you guys are the ones over at The Intercept who published this very powerful story about Michael Bloomberg. And it just goes to show you, I think there's two things here. A, that Bloomberg is wholly bought and paid for. But C, I mean, B, what it really is the media doesn't seem to cover this because this is the type of entanglement which is totally acceptable to them. Yeah. Having foreign business interests like this is just, oh, that's how you make $60 billion in this country.
Right. Yeah. And it undermines his argument that he's making to the American people. Mm-hmm. And voters, not just in this country, but in others, when they get skeptical about the corruption among their elites and in their government, they often are susceptible to this argument from a super rich person, whether it's Berlusconi yes. or somebody else, that, well, I'm so rich that I can't be corrupted.
Right.
Like, I don't need your money. I'm not going to steal from you. And you'll hear voters say that. And there's a certain logic to it. I get it. People said it with Trump. Mm-hmm. But what this shows is actually he is under the thumb
right.
of a lot of different entanglements, and very specifically of China, and that he can be pushed around by just moving the knob a little bit on the purchases of his precious expensive Bloomberg terminals.
Exactly.
And not just that, but all of the other entanglements that a kind of multinational empire,
well, we're
corporate empire, has with China.
Right. Well, here's what we've heard is that we're going to get his financial disclosures. I don't know when. It's going to be several yeah. thousand pages long.
We'll see.
But there's a lot of very interesting things in this, which is, I mean, you've covered this, Ryan, and we're going to talk about this a little bit later, which is that often his public positions happen to coincide with Bloomberg yeah. investments and with things that happen to be in Bloomberg bond index funds that happen to benefit the bottom line of his company. Why do you think he's flacking for Goldman Sachs and all these other people? They're his yeah. customers, right? Yeah. They made him. I think Max Alvarez said on the show once, he said, people think that Michael Bloomberg can't be bought because he can't be bought by special interests. But when you're worth $60 billion, you are a special interest. Yep. You are a like an entity in and of yourself of that you have been so corrupted that you're already like right. this physical manifestation of the system to even get there in the first place.
Right, and you become so consumed by your wealth that you, yes. you just want to see it expand. So it's not as if he needs more money to make the next rent check.
Right.
He's fine at the end of every month. Mm-hmm. But there's just, at that level, there's a status symbol with being the eighth richest person in the country,
right.
whatever, 20th richest person in the world, whatever it is. And if you look at even a lot of his philanthopy, is gear, it just coincidentally helps a lot right. of his business.
I covered this yesterday as well, which is that his philanthropy, about $10 billion over the course of his life, well, it's weird. The year he decided to run for president, it went up by 500% to $3.3 right. billion. So $3.3 billion, all geared towards Democratic causes, which coincidentally helped buy mayoral endorsements and more. I think people need to understand this is like the perfect thing of the whole U.S. economy to me, which is like you ship stuff over to China, these financial elites get rich, then they buy off the political establishment to flack for the financial elites. And who gets screwed the entire time? Workers. And yep. average Americans, yep. they're the ones who get screwed.
And as Naomi yep. Klein, my colleague at The Intercept, mm-hmm. has written about, he's done a lot of very good work shutting down coal plants. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, his investments were heavily in natural gas.
There you go. Yeah.
Maybe he really hates coal plants, but it just happens that yeah. the more you drive coal into the ground, the better off your fracking investments do. And that's a significant way that he really multiplied right. his wealth while he was mayor.
That is that's an excellent point. And again, how are you supposed to disentangle his green policy yeah. from his fracking investments? You can't. This is a man, by the way, who claims he's going to spend $2 billion to defeat Trump. He makes $2 billion a year, right?
Right.
His net worth increased. Yeah. He wrote off a year's salary? Okay.
Right. Like, he makes yeah. more in interest than Tom Steyer's worth.
Exactly.
And a quick point on yeah. the bravery of Lita to come forward with mm-hmm. this with this story. We were going to put the death threats that she'd been getting in the headline of the story.
Yeah.
But I ended up taking that out because the idea of death threats has been so denuded of its meaning mm-hmm. with people whining on Twitter
right.
all the time.
They get sent
a guillotine
right.
or they get, go take a long walk off a short pier and people are like, oh, I'm getting death threats.
Yeah.
No, you're not getting death threats. You're getting mean tweets. She was getting right. death threats from people who had killed before for the same reasons.
And that is why that woman is so courageous, to stand up to the second most powerful government in the entire world. I'm sure she still has
relatives. While she was in China. I mean, she's not
China.
There now, but she was there.
While she was there, I mean, that is one of those, It was one of those things where we would never know the story if it wasn't for her courage. And imagine, I mean, being pressured by a multi-billion dollar corporation who will financially ruin you if you don't stop speaking out. And she still chose not to do that. So we really commend her for doing that. And thank you guys for publishing it, seriously. All right, more on Bloomberg coming up next. Ryan's got some details on what may be Bloomberg's apology tour.